murder and mystery. June was a month of loss and confusion for many. The companies that had performative activism finally gave to growing pressures of the confused anti-LGBTQIA+ consumer. Redefined terms such as agenda and woke are being used more like inappropriate slurs than their intended definitions. Drag queens are being heckled by jobless men and women that want to protect kids, whilst scaring kids in the process. People are still saying they care about kids, but don't protect them from gun violence and environmental abuses that affect their mental health. Mob mentality, just like the Nazi regime, is reemerging to back the jobless and ignorant adults that hate trans people using bathrooms and ethnic history classes. This June feels even more intense, like our realities are going to implode, but our phone consumption couldn't have prepared us for what was to fill every news outlet these past weeks and make us forget our own realities. Humans and almost all other animals depend on oxygen in the atmosphere or water to produce energy at the cellular level necessary for survival. Most sea animals extract oxygen directly from ocean water, while land animals breathe air from Earth's atmosphere, which consists of about 21% pure oxygen. The ocean, seas, and rivers have been a source of help for all living beings. But the true nature of the ocean is dark, rough, and a lot of the times, unforgiving. Now, this will be a two-part chapter about the lives affected these past weeks. One that consumed all media and the other that barely received coverage due to classism and possible racism. The submersible that killed five will be the topic of discussion today, and the refugee boat to safety will be uploaded next week. But before we go on, hey y'all, I'm Jay, and you're about to start chapter 3, part 1 of It Girl in Crime, Murder, and Mystery that can be viewed on all streaming platforms. This is where I discuss in detail documentaries, film reenactments, and short content minis that encompass a topic of crime, murder, and or mystery in each chapter. And as I hinted last week, today and next week's topic are of mystery. The film or content discussed will always be referenced and also linked in the description box. The reference content can typically be seen or heard on easily accessible streaming services or social media platforms that inform us, the viewer, of catastrophic and unimaginable events that took place in our past. Now, if you can, please follow me on Spotify, Google, or Apple Podcasts, YouTube, and other streaming platforms that can be found in the description box. So if you didn't know, I have a new segment on all podcast platforms called Thursday Minis. It's short form content about cases and stories that do not have enough information to be long form. These episodes come out on Thursdays and are broadcasted on every podcast platform except YouTube. I have a YouTube playlist called Thursday Minis Previews if you were curious to listen to the first few minutes of each mini. This week's Thursday Mini is about mystery as well, actually. I'm telling you, these short form episodes are juicy. Just type in It Girl in Crime, Murder, and Mystery on your podcast service of choice. Now, I got this idea for this chapter from the overbearing media. You couldn't turn left, right, up, or down without hearing about the five submersible victims. And even till this day, weeks later, it's still everywhere. There are so many levels to this case today that I want to get into. Now, before I go on, hit that follow button and come along this journey with me. Let's begin. Though everyone is using the word submarine, it was actually a submersible. The difference between a submarine and a submersible is that a submarine has enough power to leave port and come back to port under its own power. But a submersible has more limited power and range. It needs a mothership from which to launch, to return to, and for support and communications. Today, we will go over who the five victims in the submersible were, who the creator of the submersible company is, the bad engineering of that submersible, the resources, aka tax money, that was used to recover them or whatever was left, if we should feel bad that wealthy people die. And lastly, my no-nonsense rant about this entire situation at the end. The first person I will discuss, and what the media continuously showed was the most important victim, was British billionaire and explorer Hamish Harding, who was 58 and was chairman of Action Aviation, a global sales company in business aviation based in Dubai. He's the main victim that has so much news coverage about his background, but not really. George Hamish Livingston Harding was born in Hammersmith, London in 1964. He spent his early childhood in Hong Kong, then at Crown Colony. He went to Pembroke College of Cambridge, a constituent college of the University of Cambridge, England, which means his college is under a Cambridge university. Hamish held 3 Guinness World Records related to his explorations by plane and into the deep ocean. He had also been to space with Jeff Bezos. Now, the question I had was Hamish an actual billionaire, or did one media outlet use this term and everyone just ran with it without fact-checking? Now, everywhere I looked, it said he was a businessman. He went to Cambridge, so he definitely came from money. The exact net worth of Hamish Harding is unknown. Due to his successful work and impressive aviation company, many news outlets, including Sky News and the BBC, have reported that Harding is a billionaire private jet dealer. However, Forbes has said that he does not appear on their list of billionaires. So what I gather is that he's a millionaire at best and maybe got his connections from family or friends and did what many wealthy people have done before him, scammed their way to the top. According to Wikipedia, in 2017, Harding worked with an Antarctic VIP tourism company, White Desert, to introduce the first regular business jet service to the Antarctic using a Gulfstream G550. Harding also visited the South Pole several times, accompanying Buzz Aldrin, a former American astronaut, in 2016, as Aldrin became the oldest person to reach the South Pole by age 86. Also, on the 9th to 11th of 2019, to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Apollo moon landing, Harding, along with Terry Virts, led a team of aviators that took the Guinness World Record for a circumnavigation of the Earth via North and South Poles in a Gulfstream G650ER in 46 hours and 40 minutes. I mean, he's an impressive adventurer, I guess. We can say that. The One More Orbit mission launched and landed at the Shuttle Landing Facility, Space Florida, at NASA Kennedy Space Center in the U.S. Harding was the mission director and led a team of 100. Now, on the 5th of March, 2021, Harding and Victor Vescovo dived to the deepest point of the Mariana Trench, the Challenger Deep, at a depth of 36,000 feet. 11,000 meters and a 2-person submarine, setting the records for greatest length covered and greatest time spent at full ocean depth. Now, Harding flew to space as part of the suborbital Blue Origin NS-21 mission on June 4th, 2022, on the 5th manned spacelift of the New Shepard rocket. Also, in September of 2022, Harding's aviation company, Action Aviation, supplied a customized Boeing 747-400 aircraft to transport 8 wild cheetahs from Namibia to India to launch the reintroduction of the Indian government and the Cheetah Conservation Fund in Namibia, aka CCF. Cheetahs have been extinct in India since India's independence in 1947. This conservation project was designated a flagged expedition by the Explorers Club, with club members Harding and Laurie Marker, founder of the CCF, carrying the flag on the flight to India. Now, with his personal background, no media outlet can really find out about Harding's career prior to owning his aviation company. Also, his parents and siblings are all unknown. Lastly, we won't even get into his troubled, racist, and ignorant stepson who didn't even have a relationship with him. No amount of autism will excuse BS, y'all. Now, the next person is French maritime and Titanic expert Paul-Henri Narjolet. He was worth $1.5 billion USD. Paul-Henri Narjolet was 73 and was director of underwater research for E&M Group and RMS Titanic Inc. He successfully dived in a submersible to the site of the Titanic wreckage 37 times and supervised the recovery of 5,000 artifacts, according to EM Group's website, which also says he was widely considered the leading authority on the wreck site. Now, he was born in Chamonix, France, on the 2nd of March, 1946. Paul-Henri lived in Africa for 13 years with his family and at 16 returned to France to complete his studies in Paris. He later joined the French Navy for a career that spanned 22 years and saw him rise in the ranks to commander from 1964 to 1986, according to the company site. Now, in 1986, the French Research Institute for the Exploitation of the Sea, also known as FREMER, contacted Narjolet about diving to the wreck of the Titanic. He heartily agreed to go. With Ephraimer, Narjolet piloted dive to the Titanic wreck site in 1987, 1993, 1994, and 1996. His 1987 expedition was the first to collect artifacts from that wreckage. As part of his Ephraimer missions, Narjolet located various artifact damage at sea. On the 15th of May, 1993, Narjolet made a dive with the Nautil and discovered by chance La Lune, which sank in 1664 near Toulon. Also in August of 2007, RMS Titanic Inc., a company owned by Premier Exhibitions, which organizes traveling expeditions, commissioned Narjolet to locate RMS Carpathia, which had rescued survivors of RMS Titanic but was torpedoed in 1918. There, Narjolet worked on the RMS Titanic to recover artifacts related to the Titanic as the director of the Underwater Research Program. His work has included utilizing remotely operated vehicles, ROV or ROV, as well as piloting dives to the wreck site. His work has also resulted in recovery of nearly 6,000 artifacts over the course of 35 dives. Okay, guys, let's pause for a freaking second. So previously, due to the media, and you know how weird the media can be, they don't fact check sometimes. Sometimes journalists just, you know, they make a mistake. So either he did 35 dives or he did 37 dives. And either it was 5,000 artifacts he recovered over his time underwater, or it was 6,000 artifacts through his time underwater. It can't be both. And that's the frustrating part with doing research, is that you just don't know, honestly, what is factual information about victims and what isn't, because the media really sometimes just doesn't do their due diligence. And therefore, I can't find the information for it either. Now, let's get back to it. In 2010, he was part of a mission to 3D map the wreck site and determine levels of deterioration using ROVs and autonomous underwater robots. As an expert on the Titanic, Narjolet participated as a creator of the two documentaries, Titanic, The Legend Lives On in 1994, and Deep Inside the Titanic in 1999. In 2022, he published Dans les profondeurs du Titanic, which reads In the Depths of the Titanic, which recounts his expeditions. The next person we will talk about is Shahzada Dawood. Some outlets have estimated his net worth being 130 million USD and some 350 million USD. Now, again, remember I told you about those media outlets, like, not giving us proper information. So don't blame me for not being as accurate as I would like to be. Okay, let's get back into it. Shahzada Dawood was 48 and was one of the richest men in Pakistan and served as vice chairman of Pakistani Engro Corporation, a Pakistani conglomerate founded as a fertilizer company where he worked for 20 years. He aspired for a sustainable future and believed in inclusive models involving low-income communities, building value chains along business interests. Dawood was born in Rawalpindi, Pakistan, on the 12th of February, 1975. He was the son of Hussein Dawood, a Pakistani businessman, investor, educationalist, and philanthropist. Shahzada Dawood received a Bachelor of Law from Buckingham University and a Master of Science in Global Textile Marketing from Philadelphia University, that is now Thomas Jefferson University. From 1996 to 2023, Dawood had been a trustee of the family foundation, the Dawood Foundation, aka TDF, which focused on education. TDF had been coordinating the Hussein Dawood Pledge, a private donation to fight COVID-19 in Pakistan. He had been focused in efforts to provide mental health support to people hit by COVID-19 in Pakistan. He was on the board of trustees for the Dawood Foundation, an education nonprofit, and he was on the board of the SETI Institute, a nonprofit research organization. Dawood had over two decades of experience in corporate governance and the transformation of industries, including growth and innovation opportunities through mergers and acquisitions of diversified public listed companies across textiles, fertilizers, food, and energy. His profile on the World Economic Forum site reads. Now, I know that was quick and simple for Mr. Dawood, but honestly, he was a nepo baby. That sounded like his obituary to the public, to be honest with you guys. He cared about helping poor people and donating to charity. He had his own charity to fight COVID-19. He merged with other companies to make his conglomerate even larger. I think that that all is just fuzziness and like distractions to like focus on who he actually was as a person. I mean, we can all say, oh, she was the nicest person in the world, or he was so kind to everyone before he passed. That's usually a cover up because people usually are kind of mean, not nice, especially uber wealthy people. They have no moral compass and they're inherently evil. Like, come on, guys. Mr. Dawood was not the only good, uber wealthy person in the world. There are none. It's impossible. They're inherently evil because they have to exploit people to gain all of that wealth in the first place. You see, between Dawood and Hamish Harding, they just say they did business deals. Oh, they were businessmen, or they went to this school, that school. They don't give you any information about how they acquire their wealth and the end all be all. Not even Najoulay. They don't even tell us how he acquired his wealth, honestly. So I find that uber wealthy people all the time, you never know how they acquired that much wealth. It's always because they exploit people, scammed a lot, and got away with it, honestly. That's how they acquired their wealth. Or like Mr. Dawood, they were born into it.
If I could prove that all 2,000 of the billionaires are evil people, Yeah, I can. It's not even very hard. So first, let's put a billion into perspective. 1 million seconds is about 12 days. 1 billion seconds is just under 32 years. Which means that if you earned $1 every single second and never spent any of it, it would take you about 32 years to earn $1 billion. If you earned $5,000 a day from the time that Columbus started his infamous voyage, it would take you about 527 years to earn $1 billion. And there are people out there with multiple billions of dollars. Based on that math, we can conclude that there's no ethical way to acquire $1 billion because there's no physically possible way to earn that money solely through the value of your own labor. Which means that in order to become a billionaire, you have to steal the labor value of thousands, if not millions, of people. And we know that this is the case. And we know that this is the case because between 1979 and 2021, the average productivity, meaning the average amount of labor value produced by the workers, has increased by 64.6%. Meanwhile, the average wage of workers has only increased by about 17.3%. That's a difference of nearly 50% labor value. So already billionaires are stealing 50% or more of their workers' labor value so that it can sit around in investment funds and stock portfolios, providing nothing of value to society.
Next is Shahzada's son, Sulman Dawood, who is 19 and loves science fiction, solving Rubik's Cubes, and playing volleyball, the New York Times reported. He was studying at the University of Strathclyde in Glasgow, according to the BBC. and a letter to the friends, followers, and community of the SETI Institute, CEO Bill Diamond shared the news of the deaths of Dawood and his son. Shahzada was passionately curious and an enthusiastic supporter of the SETI Institute and our mission, being directly involved in philanthropic programs in education, research, and public outreach, and that he will be deeply missed by all who knew him, especially his fellow trustees and the leadership of the SETI Institute. After saying all that with the 19-year-old, there was some rumor, I don't know where it started, maybe from a blog or just a random person starting rumors, that said that the son did not want to go. He was having second thoughts about going, but he only went to please his father, even though he did not want to go into the submersible. Well, according to his mom, that came out with her own interview, we found out that was false, that he really was excited to go with his father on the submersible and do an adventure together. So again, I felt like that was the media kind of trying to give sympathy for the uber wealthy. Whether he's 19 years old or not, I feel like people don't really realize that if you're uber rich at 19, you're not going to give up all your money or donate all of your money to please the masses. You're going to keep it, hoard it, and make it grow. So the 19-year-old, definitely, even though people have sympathy for him, he wasn't going to change. I think the movies and media really do warp our minds and make us believe that these fairy tales are possible and that, you know, these billionaires, millionaires, multimillionaires, you know, whoever is just going to stop their life and give people who need it a dollar or two when they would never do that. It's the Scrooge effect. Now, who remembers the movie, well, the multiple movies, the reenactments of Scrooge and the Grinch? They're mean as heck, grumpy all the time. And then all of a sudden, you know, one person, usually a child, comes about and says, hey, stop being mean. There's more to life than being grouchy. And then all of a sudden, their frown turns upside down. They're happy. They love life. And they're giving all of their wealth to people who need it and to poor people. Guys, that's a fairy tale. 19 or 60, they're not going to pee on you if you're on fire, okay? Let's get out of that mentality of that. There's hope because he's young. No, he's in a secluded atmosphere with uber wealthy people and has expectations to keep the family's money growing when he gets into the money himself. Okay, let's get back to it, guys. And the last person we will talk about today is Stockton Rush, who is 61 and founded OceanGate in 2009, which is the submersible that killed everyone. He was also the co-founder of the OceanGate Foundation, a nonprofit organization which aims to catalyze emerging marine technology to further discoveries in marine science, history, and archaeology, according to the company's website. Stockton Rush's net worth is $25 million, and OceanGate's valuation is $66 million. Now, according to Wikipedia, Richard Stockton Rush III was born on March 31st and was an American businessman. Here we go with the businessman, guys. I told y'all that's their only qualification, apparently, to be billionaires and millionaires. Rush was born into a wealthy family in San Francisco, California. He was the youngest of five children born to Richard Stockton Rush Jr. of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and Ellen Davies of San Francisco. He began scuba diving at age 12 and became a commercial pilot at 18 years old. Now, he was ambitious. His maternal grandmother, Louise Davies, was a philanthropist and the namesake of the Louise M. Davies Symphony Hall in San Francisco. Through his father, he was a descendant of two signers of the Declaration of Independence, Richard Stockton and physician Benjamin Rush. Before graduating from Princeton University with a degree in aerospace engineering in 1984 and obtaining a master's degree in business admin from the University of California in 1989, Rush prior had obtained his captain's rating at the United Airlines Jet Training Institute. He went on to oversee business ventures that included serving on the board of Seattle's Blue View Technologies and as chairman of Remote Control Technology. Nepo baby, he did not get those from hard work, guys. Come on. OceanGate's founder and CEO, Richard Stockton Rush III, was, prior to his death, married to Wendy Rush, the great-great-granddaughter of Isidore and Ida Strauss, who chose to remain on board the sinking Titanic together so that others could escape to safety in their place. Do y'all really think those rich people really gave up their spot on the boat for poor people? Okay. They were the real-life inspiration behind the heartbreaking scene in James Cameron's movie in which an elderly couple embraces in bed as water rushes into their room. Maybe insert clip, if I can. Wendy Rush is also OceanGate's communications director and has been involved with its Titanic expeditions since they began in 2021. I get the whole obsession when it's your family history, but I'm sure she has regrets for letting her husband continue lacking safety on that vessel. Now, this is how it all began with Rush and OceanGate. Stockton Rush began looking into purchasing a submersible, but discovered there were fewer than 100 privately owned submarines worldwide and was unable to purchase one. He instead constructed a miniature submersible using blueprints provided to him by a retired U.S. Navy submarine commander. The vessel Rush constructed was 12 feet long and capable of diving to a depth of 30 feet. Following the construction of his miniature submersible, he continued to try and purchase a submersible, including attempting to buy Steve Fawcett's submersible vehicle following Fawcett's 2007 death, but he was unsuccessful. He believed that there could be significant market for underwater ocean tourism and that it would provide an alternative to the significant time and technical gear required for scuba diving. That's when Rush founded OceanGate with his business partner, Guillermo Solline, in 2009. According to Rush, the goal of the company was to use commercial tourism to support the development of new deep diving submersibles that would enable further commercial ventures, including resource mining and disaster mitigation. Now, those were the five victims: one billionaire, three possible millionaires, and a college student. The media, like I said in the opening, for some reason doesn't allow the entire truth of those prominent victims to be known. They will make up false narratives just to cover a story as quickly as possible. Now, I'm sure we'll find out more, not just about the five victims, but of the co-owner Stockton Rush. Now, while conducting market research for OceanGate, Rush determined that the private market for underwater exploration had floundered due to a public regulation for danger and increased regulatory requirements on the operation of tourist submarines and submersibles. This is where he believed these reasons were understandable, but illogical, and that the perception of danger far exceeded the actual risk. In particular, he was critical of the Passenger Vessel Safety Act of 1993. Which is a United States law which regulated the construction of ocean tourism vessels and prohibited dives below 150 feet, which Rush described as a law which needlessly prioritized passenger safety over commercial innovation. Y'all, the more I read, the more I'm like, dang, he kind of deserved it. He deserved it. Now, by 2023, Rush had made at least 13 trips to the Titanic. Prior to the June 2023 dive, Rush was sued by a couple in Florida over a planned 2018 dive to the Titanic that they claim was repeatedly canceled and postponed. The couple claimed that they were unable to get a refund due to Rush's actions. Now, this is important. Now, in a 2022 podcast with CBS reporter David Pogue, Rush discussed his attitude toward what he perceived as excessive safety precautions. And I quote, "You know, at some point, safety just is pure waste. I mean, if you want to be safe, don't get out of bed and don't go in your car. Don't do anything. At some point, you're going to take some risk. And it really is a risk/reward question. I think I can do this just as safely by breaking the rules." End quote. Y'all, he deserved it. He deserved it. Now let's talk about the bad engineering of that submersible. The Titan submersible was deliberately designed to be low tech to save on costs and avoid timely research and development, says a subcontractor who helped build it. Doug Vernig, who helped with the development of Ocean Gate's Titan, which is operated with a wireless Logitech video game controller, says it uses as many off-the-shelf components as possible to save on costs and timely research and development. Now, Vernig added that Ocean Gate's main interest was researching the ocean rather than adventure tourism. That's a lie because Rush said it was adventure tourism, I'm just saying. He said the expeditions, which cost up to $250,000 for a seat, were simply a way for funding the research. The submersible set off the 96 hours of air, according to Ocean Gate, meaning its oxygen would likely be depleted at around 12:08 p.m. UK time. But precisely when depends on the factors such as weather and how calm those on board are, experts say, and whether the craft is still intact. Referring to the $30 Logitech gaming controller, Vernig told CNN, "It seems kind of cheesy, but if you knew the amount of technology that was packed in that controller and its capabilities and the amount of money that it costs to develop something like that, it's just off the charts." So if you can take these components off the shelf and incorporate them into a project like this when you don't have the research and development timelines and expense, that, I believe, is a wise choice. Y'all, Vernig, the subcontractor, is crazy too. The reviews for that controller are abysmal. Vernig stressed OceanGate had gone cutting edge where they needed to. He said the submersible company had incorporated a good bit of conventional wisdom during its development. The ex-Titan subcontractor added that he thought the 22-foot, 6.7-meter carbon fiber vessel would eventually be found. It hasn't been found, y'all. It has a titanium dome door, and that's not going anywhere, Vernig said. That thing is indestructible. It's a huge hunk of metal, so there are ways to detect that, and they'll find it. They didn't find it. The submersible had 7 backup systems to return to the surface, including sandbags and lead pipes and an inflatable balloon. The submersible does not have a GPS system. Okay. Instead, it uses Elon Musk's Starlink to communicate with the tracking team on its mothership, MV Polar Prince, via short text messages. Elon Musk always gotta pop up. The sub is meant to communicate with the main ship, which in 2005 was listed on eBay with a reserve price of $1 million every 15 minutes to inform the team of its location. Jesus, $1 million every 15 minutes? On board, there are no seats and only one toilet, a small black box containing Ziploc bags and a black curtain drawn across and music played for privacy. Yet, the company's website recommends you restrict your diet before and during the dive to reduce the likelihood that you will need to use the facilities. The walls of the sub are heated because conditions can become extremely cold. It comes after newly uncovered allegations that suggested there had been significant warnings made about the vessel's safety during the submersible's development. One of the company's first customers characterized a dive he made to the site 2 years ago as a kamikaze operation. Imagine a metal tube a few meters long with a sheet of metal for a floor. You can't stand, you can't kneel. Everyone is sitting close to or on top of each other, said Arthur Loy, a retired businessman and adventurer from Germany. You can't be claustrophobic, is what he said. Now, what happened? The timeline from independent.co.uk. The Polar Prince icebreaker sailed around 900 miles off the coast of Newfoundland, where it set anchor. The 5-person crew was dropped into the ocean and their 22-foot-long submersible vessel, the Titan. And around 8 a.m. Eastern time, the submersible was launched. 1 hour and 45 minutes later, the vessel lost contact with the Polar Prince. The vessel was programmed to send out a ping every 15 minutes to indicate its location. The final signal was sent at around 10 a.m. Eastern time. Now, the Titan typically takes around 2 hours to reach the Titanic wreckage located around 4,000 meters beneath the ocean. According to the Coast Guard, the sub was meant to surface at 3 p.m. Eastern time. Now, when it failed to resurface, the crew raised the alarm with authorities at 5:40 p.m. Eastern time. During the 2.5-hour descent and ascent, the lights were turned off to conserve energy, he said, with the only illumination coming from a fluorescent glow stick. The dive was repeatedly delayed to fix a problem with the battery and the balancing weights. In total, the voyage took 10.5 hours. Documents also show that OceanGate had been warned there might be catastrophic safety problems posed by the way the experimental vessel was developed. Now, David Lockridge, OceanGate's Director of Marine Operations, said in a 2018 lawsuit that the company's testing and certifications was insufficient and would subject passengers to potential extreme danger in an experimental submersible. The company insisted that Lockridge was not an engineer and was not hired or asked to perform engineering services on the Titan. The firm also says the vessel under development was a prototype, not the now missing Titan. The Marine Technology Society, which describes itself as a professional group of ocean engineers, technologists, policymakers, and educators, expressed their concern that year in a letter to Rush, OceanGate's chief executive. The society, in documents first reported by the New York Times, said it was critical that the company submit its prototype to tests overseen by an expert third party before launching in order to safeguard passengers. Now, let's get into the resources used to help. On Monday morning, authorities revealed the Titan was missing and a large-scale search operation had been launched. The U.S. Coast Guard revealed they had begun a sweeping search of a 5,000-square-meter area about 900 miles off the coast of Cape Cod, Massachusetts. The Canadian Coast Guard said it, too, was taking part in the effort with fixed-wing aircraft and a ship. At 1:30 p.m., the U.S. Coast Guard's Northeast tweeted that a C-130 Hercules Renaissance aircraft had been dispatched to search for the Titan. A P-8 Poseidon aircraft with underwater sonar capabilities joined the search on Monday afternoon. The submersible craft, including an unmanned U.S. Navy Curve 21, which can reach a depth of 4,000 meters, also joined the search. The Polar Prince and 106 Rescue Wing continued to conduct researches throughout Monday evening. On Tuesday, a Canadian aircraft P-3 Aurora joined the effort as the search area expanded to 10,000 square meters. Captain Frederick said, and I quote, "Since Sunday, the Coast Guard has coordinated search efforts with the U.S. and Canadian Coast Guard, Air National Guard aircraft, and the Polar Prince, the Titan's mothership, which has searched a combined 7,600 square miles, an area larger than the state of Connecticut. On Wednesday, according to internal email updates sent to Department of Homeland, the first photo emerged of the Deep Energy Rescue Ship, which carries two remote-operated vehicles, ROVs, capable of operating to a depth of 3,000 meters, arriving at the search site on Wednesday. The John Cabot, which has side-scanning sonar capabilities, the Scandi Inland and the Atlantic Merlin also arrived at the search site on Wednesday morning, the U.S. Coast Guard said in a Twitter post. The Royal Canadian Navy also deployed HMCS Glace Bay, which carries a medical team specializing in dive medicine. On board the ship is a 6-person mobile hyperbaric recompression chamber that can be used to treat or prevent decompression sickness. However, the French ship Atalante, carrying the Victor 6000 underwater ROV, the only one capable of reaching the Titanic wreck 4,000 meters under the ocean surface, had a narrow window of time to conduct rescue operations as it only reached the search site on Wednesday night. Now, y'all know throughout this, they're losing oxygen. Allegedly, if they were still on board, they'd be losing so much oxygen. So it was like a rushed event to find them as quickly as possible. So now, do we all see the effort and some of the new never-before-seen technology being used from all these countries wanting to help? It seemed more like an effort for these government agencies to fight to be first than to rescue the 5 victims. More for notoriety rather than a good deed. Now, as y'all saw, I could barely pronounce most of those vessels. The amount of taxpayers' money from England, USA, Canada, even France used for the search in the North Atlantic was astronomical. Like, our tax money was used. The U.S. couldn't wait to flex their military muscles in waters that aren't even in their jurisdiction. A lot of this type of help could have been used for Hurricane Katrina or even the refugee boat that capsized that we'll discuss next week. Now, I hope after listening to this, you hear how much actual help can be done for everyone who's in horrendous situations. But sadly, unless you're rich or get the mainstream media to project your issue, the government agencies won't get praise or notoriety. Therefore, they are a lot less likely to help anyone. Now, I asked myself during this incident, did the rich people deserve to die? Well, I'm a part of the community of Eat the Rich. That means it. Hoarding that much wealth between them is despicable. To even reach that level of wealth means a lot of average Joes had to suffer and be left destitute. When the rich decide to give back, they do so by way of friends and families, organizations, and charities, using their words to give back, but their money to sustain and solidify these charities. Eat the rich means just that. And again, for anyone commenting to defend any of them, even the 19-year-old, do you think the 19-year-old was going to grow to be any different than every other wealthy person? You must believe that he was going to inherit all that wealth and give it to you or your kids, huh? The You Never Know crowd are the same ones that can relate to Sophia Richie and believe they are just a plaid skirt away from being rescued by a billionaire. And am I going to lose sleep over any of them losing their lives? No, because in their social circles, cost-cutting and safety-ignoring is a normality. But I will say the only person that deserved what they got was the Ocean Gate owner, Mr. Rush. He put those four people's lives in harm's way on purpose. The rich on that vessel, honestly, to his point, probably didn't care the owner cut costs. They may have not, because as wealthy people, no matter what, they cut costs of employees and underpay them, and they manipulate their way to this status. Mr. Rush wasn't doing anything that these other victims wouldn't have done, honestly.
And when we start to take certain other things into account, it gets even worse. There are currently over 582,000 homeless people in the United States, many of which are children. And in the year 2020, there were more than 34 million food insecure people in the United States. That's about 10% of the population that doesn't know where their next meal is going to come from. Now, do you know how much it would cost to end homelessness in the United States? According to the Department of Housing and Urban Development, it would cost $20 billion to end homelessness in the United States. And there are currently 770 billionaires in the United States, putting aside the fact that Elon Musk alone could end homelessness for half the cost of what he paid for Twitter. If we split it up evenly across all 770 of them, each of them would only have to pay out a lowly $26 million. And yet, despite the ease with which they could end homelessness in the United States, billionaires are wasting their money on vanity projects like dying in a sub at the bottom of the ocean and buying Twitter. There is no room for billionaires in an ethical society. They quite simply shouldn't exist.
OceanGate co-owner Stockton Rush knew the consequences, but since his life worked out so far with taking risks, like the rich person he is, he did not care. So with that, thank you so much for watching Chapter 3, Part 1 of It Girl and Crime, Murder, and Mystery. This has been a very interesting episode, so thank you for listening. Now sound off in the comments. Do you believe Ocean Gate's owner, Stockton Rush, put everyone in harm's way and deserved what he got? Do you agree that Hamish Harding wasn't a billionaire? And lastly, did the five victims warrant this extreme amount of media coverage of their tragedy? If not, tell me why. Subscribe, like, and follow on all podcast platforms linked in the description box. See y'all on the next episode for Chapter 3, Part 2, where we discuss the refugee victims whose boat capsized. Ciao!